WGTN WTJR presents Friends of Wild Olive Branch Ministries with Kyle Kopp and David Vance, serving the Yeshua. Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. And now, today's message.
Lamentations 3, verse 17 says, "My life was bereft of peace. I forgot what happiness was." Verse 18, "I thought my strength and hope had perished before the Lord." 19, "To recall my distress and my misery was wormwood and poison." And verse 20, "Whenever I thought of them, I was bowed low." Are you there today? Have you been there in the past and not knowing how to get out precisely, but through help and friends and whatnot, you did? But stay tuned, because we're going to talk about this, because there is no reason not to be happy in Jesus' name. So Kyle's going to pray here, and we welcome you to the show, and we thank you for tuning in. And this is going to be an interesting show. I'm telling you, it's a kingdom principle. Don't miss it. And you can hear it again and again if you like.
That's right.
So
stay tuned.
Welcome, sir.
Yeah, well, good morning. Good morning to all of you out there in TV land. It's always good to be here at WTJR, and we're glad you've tuned in today. The Lord is something very specific He's laid on my brother's heart, and I would too encourage you to stay tuned. Be ready. Be ready to receive. Be ready to act. Be ready to do. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank You this day for all that You are and all that You continue to be. We bring glory and honor to You, for You are worthy to be worshipped and to be praised and adored. We thank You today, Father God, for the listening audience, each and every one. We pray that they would have ears to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to them, that they receive it with gladness, and that they act upon those words, Heavenly Father. Give them the courage and the strength to stand. Give them the courage and the strength to say yes to You. Father, we do, we are, and we continue to praise and to magnify You for all that You are. Father God, we thank You for this, the United States of America. We thank You for this election year, Heavenly Father. We pray that You would lead and guide and direct us into whom to vote for during this time. I pray, Father God, as well, that we take we just yearn and listen and pay attention and take seriously the privilege we have as Americans to vote. I pray, Lord God, that we would take it seriously and that You would lead, guide, and direct us into that, Father. We thank You for the leadership of our country. We pray for them. We pray first and foremost that they would surrender their lives, that they would repent and come to know You, the living God, through the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank You for the men and the women in the field as well, that they work to protect us and protect this country. Keep them, protect them, and lead them mostly to You. Draw them unto Yourself, Heavenly Father. We also stand as believers for the nation of Israel. We Amen. Thank You for Israel. We thank You, Father God, that You are blessing Israel, that You're keeping Israel, and that we as a country are going to unite once again to support them 100%.
Amen.
No compromise.
Amen.
And we just thank You for that right now, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. It's serious stuff.
Absolutely.
We have to, as a country, support Israel.
There's no question about it. And why, you know, you mentioned the election, so on and so forth, and we just reiterate, you know, to vote. But because our relationship with Israel is so critical.
It is critical.
And I say that because in Genesis it says, those who bless Israel will be blessed.
Blessed.
That's the United States.
Amen.
If we bless Israel, we'll be blessed. If we divide Israel by take a land deal or whatever, it will divide America.
It will.
I'm telling you, there are too many too many things that I've come across in reading and hearing people speak and so on and so forth that's tied all of this to Scripture. There is, without a shadow of a doubt, we have to support Israel for America to be blessed. That's why we've been blessed all these years.
Amen.
And you know, but when we start seeing hurricanes hitting different places, tornadoes, so on and so forth, listen, a lot of times, matter of fact, most times, you can tie it directly to something that happened politically in Israel that we were a cause of.
Yeah.
And so I'm just saying we need to bless Israel and view your candidates and know their position.
That's right.
Some have already said that one in particular, that they're not, you know, that Israel will have to compromise. No way. God's not going to let Israel be divided.
That's right.
So if this country's to go on and be a strong and wonderful country that it is, we have to bless Israel.
That's right. Amen. It's a good word. It's absolutely true. Take some time. Bless Israel, everybody.
Amen.
Put them forward in your prayers.
Well, when I was reading Lamentations the other day, come across this, you know, my life didn't have any peace, it says. In Lamentations 3:17.
Excuse me.
My life didn't have peace. We were so low, we didn't, you know, we'd been so beat up, so down and out that we forgot what happiness was. You come across people like that. There's a lot of people like that.
Yeah, there are.
And whenever we think, you know, our hopes from the Lord's just gone.
Yeah.
Somehow we blame God.
Yeah.
And that peace is gone. That strength, your strength is gone. Your hope's gone. You know, and that's not a good place to be.
No, it's not.
Because fear will make you do things. And by the way, fear is associated with that primarily because fear, you know, once it starts down, you got bill collectors knocking on your door saying, we want paid. Well, I don't have a job. We want paid. I don't care if you have to sell your kids. You know, we want paid. So fear and anxiety will make you do things that you normally would not do.
It's true.
It's a torment. Fear is a torment. It's the opposite of faith.
Amen.
And so I want to start here in Luke. So we need to know how to get out of it, okay? And we need to know what our position is as children of the living God.
Amen.
Okay? And what our covenant is with our living God. So let's go to Luke chapter 6, verse 20. And he says, and solemnly lifting up his eyes on his disciples, he said, you are blessed in God's favor and salvation apart from your outward condition, and you are poor and lowly and afflicted, or in other words, you're destitute of wealth and influence and position and honor, for the kingdom of God is yours. Now, that brings us to an interesting, we should ask ourselves, well, what is the kingdom of God? Where is the kingdom of God? Because those are important things to know. Most of us don't even think about God having a kingdom.
Right.
But he does, and we need to know what it is and where is the kingdom of God. So to answer that question, where is the kingdom? Let's turn to Luke chapter 17. verse 21. Nor will people say, look, here he is, or see, there he is. For behold, the kingdom of God is within you, in your heart, and among you, in other words, surrounding you. So it answers where the kingdom of God is. The kingdom of God's out there for everyone that believes and receives and knows. Mm-hmm. But the kingdom of God is in your heart. That's where the kingdom of God is. It's not some place that we can go to. It's not like some religion, you know, well, Mecca, for example, would be a place where some might think that that's where the kingdom of God is because it's a special holy place. It is to those folks, but the Word of God says that the kingdom is in our heart. So if it's in our heart, we have to examine our hearts.
Yes.
Now, every kingdom, you know, the Holy Spirit's in us, first of all, but the answer to the question, where is the kingdom, the answer is, once again, and I'm repeating myself for a purpose here because you have to know this. The answer is in you. Now, what does a kingdom infer? If I said, such and such has a kingdom, what would that infer to you?
Well, if they have a kingdom, they would be the king of the kingdom.
Right. And does kingdoms have laws?
Certainly.
And they have rules.
Absolutely.
Okay. The kingdom of God is no different. The kingdom of God has laws. We need to know what it is.
Has a king, has laws.
They're set.
Yep.
And they work every time.
Right.
And see, a lot of times people say, well, you know, God didn't do this. He failed me. Or I sought God and he disappointed me. But I would question, do they really know where the kingdom of God is? And do they really know the laws of the kingdom that's in their heart?
Right.
And I would venture to say that most
don't.
Of those do not.
Correct.
And so, once again, the kingdom's a type of government. It is a government, and it has laws. We can learn those laws, and we have access to those laws. But let's go to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, 18 and 19. And remember, the question is, the thought is, we have access to the laws. Let's go to the Word of God to prove it. For it is through him that we both, whether far off or near, now have an introduction and access by one Holy Spirit to the Father. So we have access, it says here in 18, that we have access through the Holy Spirit to the Father, who's the head of the kingdom. The Father God. Okay, so we have access. Now, and we, because we have access, the last half of that verse in the Amplified says, so we are able to approach him.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, therefore, in verse 19, you are no longer outsiders, you're not exiled, you're not migrants, you're not aliens, you're not excluded from the rights of citizenship. with the saints, but you're excluded from the rights of citizens. But you are now share citizenship with the saints, God's own people, consecrated and set apart for himself, and you belong to God's own household. So if you belong to God and you're part of His household, then you have access to Him. You know, just be like a father. Your children have access to you.
Right.
Because in a small realm world, you're the head of the house. Your government, your rules govern what happens in your house. Mm-hmm. The rule, you have a set of rules that your children all know.
Right.
So, and because we have citizenship through the Holy Ghost because of Jesus, you know, we have access. We are heirs to the throne. So if we're an heir, we're part of that government system. They're part of the kingdom that governs that system. So we have access to the Father God. That's what I want to get across to you. You have access. Now, just because you have access doesn't necessarily mean that you know how to get what you're accessing, if that makes sense.
Yes, it does make sense in light of... you have to know what your benefits are. You have to know where the glasses are in the cupboard. You need to know in the refrigerator, you know, where do I find the meat? Where do I find the vegetables?
Right.
And I know those are very practical things, but here's the long and short of it. We're talking about the kingdom, and we're talking about the laws of the kingdom. Yes, as a believer, the kingdom does reside within you, but if you don't know where to find anything, a.k.a. you don't know the laws of the kingdom, you can't apply those laws to your life and use them to help you with the struggles and the things that happen in this world. You have to get within you what those requirements are.
Absolutely.
And that means that you're going to study. That means that you're going to get more in depth into the Word of God and understand more about what His promises are for you. You know, we all get into those bad days, as He described when He opened up with Lamentations, and we're not happy and we're not content and we're not satisfied. That's because we don't understand the rules in the kingdom.
Right. Let's use a natural law. If I took this Bible and I dropped it off the side of this table, and let's just say that there was a pool of water underneath.
Okay.
Would this book float?
No. It might, well, it might for a second or two till it gets saturated.
Well, but my point is it going to, if it does bounce around for a brief moment.
Right. It's going to sink.
Getting technical on me here.
Sorry.
But no, this book is not going to float on water.
Right.
It's going to sink. Now, why do you know that? What law in nature...
Gravity.
Very good. What law in nature has rule over, if I drop that,
it's going down. Gravity.
Not going up.
Right.
It's not even going to float.
Right.
Because a book does not float in water
normally.
Okay?
No, right.
So, yet people expect things like that to happen in their Christian walk.
Yeah, they do.
Not realizing
lollipops and rainbows.
Not realizing that there's immutable laws operating.
Correct.
Now, we're taping here, and on top of this building is a tower. Okay? So if I climbed up to the top of that tower, which is not likely to begin with.
Amen.
But and I didn't have a parachute on.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say, well, if I jump off of here, you know, kind of like the devil did to Jesus. You know, he took him up to the top of the mountain.
Yeah.
You know, if you just, your angels will kick you. Well, you could think the same thing. If I'm a Christian guy, I climb to the top of the tower, I'm going to fly. Once again, is that okay? No, it's crazy. Why is it crazy? Because the law governing that, me jumping off, is gravity, and it's going to win every time.
Right.
And I go, splat. Okay? But yet we have Christians all over the world expecting like things like that to happen for them, for money just to fall from heaven when they need it at their opportune time to spend on the lust of the flesh.
Right.
And then they become disappointed, disheartened, sad, forgetting what happiness in the Lord is, forgetting all of that because it didn't happen to them and for them at their request. We have to ask why. Why do people do that? They do it because they do not know what the laws of the kingdom are.
Yeah.
So, are the laws in here? Yes.
Yes.
But it's just like the laws in the state of Illinois. Just because I know a few laws, I certainly don't know all the laws.
Oh, goodness, no. Right.
That there is in the state of Illinois, driving down a road, for example. I know most of them,
yeah.
But I don't know all of them.
Right.
You know, why? Well, because I've never taken time to study them,
yep.
To be honest with you.
Yep.
And the same principle applies here.
It does.
If you've never taken the time to study what the laws of the kingdom are and how to access them and how to apply them, then you're not going to be successful.
Right.
And that's what I'm trying to get across to you. It's an easy situation, but if you find yourself in that, then you're going to have to ask yourself seriously this question. If I'm not getting the results that I've seen others get, why?
Where's the disconnect?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Where is the disconnect, and how do I connect?
We talked a little bit about that coming over this morning.
Yeah.
We know a gentleman whom we both respect and have bought machinery from, who we don't really know where he stands spiritually, but he's very ill right now. He's had one tumor removed from his brain, and now he has another one growing. This man's in his 40s. He's not old by any means. And the question I posed to my brother, to David, was, you know, it would seem, and I've not been in this man's position, and I'm by no means judging him. However, if the doctors are giving you no hope, and they're doing everything they know to do, and it's not working, and you don't believe it's time for you to go yet, whether because you're not saved or just because you're young, wouldn't it make sense to look in the Bible, get to know what the Scriptures have to say about healing from front to back, and apply those principles in your heart, irregardless of what's going on with the pictures and the tumors, because you've got to know, you've got to get those things into your heart so that you can answer those questions when they come. And so many times we've been led to believe, and I spoke it as David was speaking a few minutes ago, what my brother is talking about is true contentment comes when you have the plan, you know the plan, and you can act on the plan. And we're talking about the kingdom plan. We're talking about the laws that govern the kingdom. We're not talking about the cups in the cupboard. We're talking about what the Word has to say concerning your spirit, what the Word has to say concerning your healing, what the Word has to say concerning the baptism of the Holy Ghost. All of these things are accessible. But you have to study, you have to apply, you have to desire, you have to be willing to go deeper. You know, anything that I've ever accomplished in life that's been truly fulfilling has come at a price. It hasn't been easy. It hasn't always been. I've had to apply, I've had to think, I've had to study. You know, for example, I have a real estate license, which I haven't used maybe 3 times in 15 years. But every 2 years, I have to take continuing education. And that means that I have to study at home and I have to study in a test setting. And it takes work. It takes time. It takes dedication to be able to pass that test. Well, this is no different what my brother's talking about. He said to you when Brother David opened today, he asked you, you know, basically to consider what it is. Why aren't you happy? Why aren't you content? And he's been sharing with you now for 20 plus minutes about the fact that it takes willingness to understand the laws that govern the kingdom that resides within you. And I just want to say before I shut up here for a second, listen, it's not easy. It's not sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows, but the rewards are endless. Endless.
Well, I would just say to you this, until the next time we meet, because we're running out of time here. But so tune in next week to get more of what we're talking about here.
Yeah.
But if you've ever said, God, you failed me. God didn't fail you.
No, he didn't.
God must not have wanted me to have this or that. God gave me this woman or this man to punish me for something. If you've ever said that, you're wrong.
Yeah. Amen.
And don't take this personal. Take it as a fact of what it is, just what it is. You're ignorant of the laws of the kingdom.
That's right.
And I'm not trying to be mean or nasty with that statement.
Not at all.
I'm just saying, because, you know, I've wondered the same things. It's part of life,
it is.
I think, sometimes.
It is.
You know, but I want you to know it's not God's fault. God didn't fail you. You failed to know the law.
Amen.
You know, in the natural, you know, if a state cop stops you, say, well, I didn't know that law applied to me. Ignorance of the law is no excuse.
It's correct.
Same thing here. Ignorance of the law is no excuse. God didn't fail you. You failed to know.
Right.
God wanted you to have things, but you failed to know how to fulfill and gather that want in.
That's right.
And that need in. So tune in tomorrow.
Yeah.
Or next week, as it were. I want you to know there's more to this.
Amen.
It's critical. It's critical. I am so tired of seeing Christians beat up and beat down because they don't know.
Yeah, amen.
And I've been there at different times, but you have to learn. We'll teach you how to learn.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, be blessed. Thanks for tuning in.
That's right.
This week on WTJR Community Calendar. There'll be blood drives on Wednesday, March 16th, 12 p.m. to 5 p.m., First Christian Church, 701 Wabash Avenue in Carthage, Illinois. And on Thursday, March 17th, 12:30 p.m. to 5:30 p.m., Fort Madison United Methodist Church, 510 9th Street in Fort Madison, Iowa. Also, there'll be a blood drive on Thursday, March 17th, 1 p.m. to 6 p.m. at the Blood Donation Center, 3000 North 23rd Street in Quincy, Illinois. To set up an appointment, call 1-800-733-2767. Greenmount Cemetery Annual Cleanup, March 14th through the 18th. Please remove all items except the Shepherd's Hook staffs by March 13th. Can replace on March the 19th. WTJR TV 16 in Quincy, Illinois, where we are working together till Jesus returns.